point is a quick, very quick overview. It's nothing lengthy. You do have two summaries in the back. You have your budget summary and your supplemental summary. I believe we're going to focus tonight just on the budget summary document, so we'll kind of get rolling. I just want to begin first by thanking the school committee for its guidance. I especially want to thank the administrative team and their staff because they worked diligently over the course of at least a month and a half, not longer, pulling together their justifications and their budget based upon the guidance they received. For our two-man business office, which is incredible, Lisa and Alicia, who just continue to impress. Thank you for your hard work. And Sherry for her multi-time review to make sure there were no spelling mistakes and no other mistakes in the document. There's a lot of work that went into it, and I just wanted to say thank you to you all for your work. And I just want to start by saying, candidly, it is truly a privilege to be able to work with this team, this staff, and this faculty. It always has been, but for some reason, especially now, just doing a great job. And again, I'll just revert back to the school committee for your guidance, and that's what we based our work on. So, I'll get rolling. Real simply, this is pretty straightforward. We're responsible to educate more than 1,700 students with many diverse needs. The North Smithfield School Committee believes that the school district budget, which is from their guidance, should directly reflect, identify, and document the funding needs to provide a quality educational plan for all of our students. So the bottom line, we accomplished this year through a draft fiscal year budget within potential fiscal parameters. And again, we received some helpful guidance from the budget subcommittee and with a few comments that were made. So we brought forward basically a budget that is approximately 2.57 increase at this time. So it is within the 4% allowable over appropriation increase. So the school committee also has, according to their policy and procedures, they have what's called a supplemental budget. We fully understand that there's not a lot in there that really has too much of a chance to see the light of day. We get that. Considering the fiscal parameters that I guess that were transferred over or related from the town. So this is always important to us because so much of what we do and it's included in so many of our documents because this is what we are guided by. You know? So clearly our mission is clear. It's to prepare each student to be a successful and responsible member of society. And again, it may seem mundane, but these things are very important to us. We do believe that all students will succeed through high expectations and standards, and that education is a shared responsibility, and we believe unequivocally in mutual respect and social responsibility. And, we believe we have effective educational practice because it's constantly based on inquiry and research. And we have an incredible commitment to reflect, assess, and constantly improve, and I hopefully see that throughout practice. And lastly, I think we believe that what we're doing is a lifelong endeavor, and that investing in education in our children really benefits the entire community. So we believe in partnership with the community that we strive to meet the educational needs of all of our children. It's important that we provide a safe educational environment and that we challenge all our students to reach their greatest potential. We strive to provide quality resources, curriculum, and instruction. So, and hopefully you've seen the success that we have. The latest little newsletter I sent out, we were recognized by several places again. So hopefully the school committee feels proud as we do that we continue to strive to be the best we can. And along the way, sometimes those people notice us. So. This is not for me to read. This is just for more public information. This is the timeline that we follow. As you can see, this document doesn't get put together in 2 weeks. So there's a lot of thought and work that goes into it. So we're at the 112 date, third from below. And I believe this school committee will most likely continue into the 19th and make a decision then. And that's due to the town administrator in February. This just, again, reiterates our fiscal planning guidance. Again, the fiscal guidelines are important. The administrators are very aware that when we start, we base it on a zero-based premise. So, and very important, we also meet identified known obligations and contract obligations are not known at the time of the budget development. Recommended combined placeholder. We have been instructed in the past to put an estimate in the budget development. So. Again, that's just the guidance, the short version of the guidance we follow administratively. So, the proposed FY17 budget is $25,295,107. We believe it's a responsible, balanced, and conservative financial plan designed with minor changes to maintain the services and programs that presently exist, provide for reasonable increases in salaries for employees, and you will see clearly in the budget support increases to curriculum, primarily textbooks and education material, technology, athletics, central office, operational budgets, and some minor increases to some building-based budgets. And they are minor, except for the high school, that was really needed. So, I'm not going to do all of this, so I'll just. Budget supports or maintains projected adjustments in employee salaries and benefits. As I said, needed adjustments to North Smithfield High School building based budget. You can read those three bullets. The third bullet is yet another unfunded mandate asked by the legislature. I think this year, Mr. McGee, Mr. Pepin, what's the cap this year that was the budget for the textbooks?
CCRI?
Yeah. What's it come in so far?
$1,000 for textbooks?
It's about $800-$900 for the first semester. Second semester would probably be the same, perhaps a bit less.
So it might be around $2,000 that was on budget. Curriculum, again, you can read the three bullets. And technology, which I think the school committee has certainly probably heard enough of or been some over the months. Athletics, the addition of high school lacrosse and track programs, central office, the out of district tuitions, charter boarding schools, maintains all schools' extracurricular programs and offerings at this point. It proposes to maintain our current staffing, except you can see the last bullet under there. I meant to asterisk that and have it slide out to the left, but North Smithfield Middle School at this time will decrease the grade 6 teacher. And the budget draft does propose the addition of a 0.5 librarian, which, as you know, it was reduced years ago for budget reductions. This would restore a previously reduced position. 0.5 guidance department clerk typist. Right now, that person works part-time in guidance and then slips over to the office because the office was reduced to secretary a couple years ago, I think. So they've been backfilling with two part-time clerks. And then central office, to their credit, I think 2 years ago, we tried to reduce a half-time person in that office, in central office, and candidly, demands have increased, and it's just bad that we restore that position. So, I'm going to turn it over to Lisa and Alicia.
Okay, as Mr. LeBert said, our plan is right now the draft is to increase the budget trying to receive an increase in general aid of $329,343, which would bring their share to $6,125,803. Medicaid, we left that level over last year, we're projecting $205,000 in revenue. And that would bring our total budget submission to $25,295,107. Of that $25.3 million, about $14,706,368 is made up of salary obligations. That's an increase of 2.3% over the previous year. And you can see within the salary obligations the different categories that are listed. Benefits. Right now, we predict that it will be up about 3% or $147,654 to bring it to a total of $5,150,157. Now, we did recently just give the trust on their rates. We originally factored in an 8% increase in health benefits and a 7% for dental. They've notified us that it's looking really good for us again next year, and we can expect a decrease. They can't give us the amount of the decrease at this point, but they did say that they're pretty sure that we will be seeing a decrease. So when we present this budget to you on the 19th with the changes, that is one of the changes that we'll build into this. We were going to build it to, we figured 0% increase, we'll just leave it level until we get back from them. If you want us to do something else, do that also. Really, it's you.
I'm sorry, Lisa, so you're going to get an estimate from them by the 19th, or a concrete number?
No, we were going to build the, when we have any revisions that you want us to implement in the draft, we will also at the same time build in the 0% increase.
But when did you say we're going to get the concrete number from them?
We will probably get
March, usually.
Can you go back there for a second, Lisa? Go back one. Why is workers' comp up? We've had a lot of claims, or one big claim? You don't have to give me the detail.
Up.
What?
It pretty much does increase every year. I'm waiting to hear back, actually, from the trust. What happens is, they don't have any stuff, they do an audit on, all of our expenditures and whatnot, and we are in line for actually credit.
Okay, that's right.
So
okay.
It might reduce our projections for next year a little bit.
Yeah.
That is the case.
Yeah, 10%
just seems high. So this is just a snapshot of the salary and benefit obligations together. In total, they make up 78% of our budget.
So salary benefits is 78%.
So this brings us to the operational portion of our budget. In total, we expect an increase of 3% or $131,675.
So Lisa, looking at the, I'll call it special ed budget, do you think there'll be some savings this year in that budget? If I see the big number for next year, you think there's some this year?
It definitely will.
Okay.
And it's all in the areas of our district.
Yeah, yeah, I'm sure, yeah, because that's the largest portion of that budget.
Take up all the money.
central office, PPS, and facilities.
Athletics must be probably 6%.
Yeah, I made it up to 3% this year. The central office budget is basically three main areas. Transportation and fuel are more than half. Our out-of-district tuition placements and our non-discretionary items like our contracts, our lawyers, etc. are all included in that.
What do you call it, non-discretionary?
Kind of have no choice. We have to pay it. You know, we can't not pay for our contracts or
okay.
our copiers or things like that.
Like, I think there's one line item in there for, not that frequently, we will host a workshop, so there's a line item in there for food. That's we put that back because only because a lot of us were paying out. That's what we mean by discretionary.
Yeah, I understand.
Like, you could cut that.
No, I don't.
Versus you can't really cut a contract, so.
And our facilities budget, unfortunately, is mainly our utility use, our energy consumption. A lot of contracts, again, are here, our water, septic, our supplies, vehicles. So 97% of their budget is pretty much utilized.
Do we pay water anyway?
Yes.
Or is it just?
Yeah.
So we
school have. The Kennedy.
Oh, okay.
And lastly, we have our PBS budget, which is solely made up of out-of-district placements and those contracted services that go along with that, and then some classroom supplies. So pretty much 100% of our PBS budget is committed. And I believe that sums us up.
Yes. So, if I may, Madam Chair, I just want to make a few comments to the public before we get into the meat of the agenda. Okay. So, folks, what you have here and what's online is the excerpts. This is really embedded all through the 2.5-inch or 3-inch notebook at some point. This really is a, I believe it's a really good tool for you to simply look at the executive summary at some point. For instance, some of what we talked about is in here, but it shows you enrollment, it shows you the staffing for next year. On page 6, it gives you a one-page detailed FY17 summary analysis that shows you kind of where the changes are in the amount. And then as you just saw, it covers major categories, so it shows you obviously that we have the bulk of our funds are in salaries and benefits, 78%. Page 8, it simply shows you the school department revenue by category. And then it covers, you know, what you saw on the pie chart, the operational budgets and their percentage. And then it does what we call the big three. Big three central office budget on page 16, I'm sorry, page 10. The PPS budget, it gives you a few excerpts on 11, 12, and then facilities on 13. But please, if you have a chance to look at the rest of it, the executive summary, I think it's really, it gives you that high level overview of where we're proposing the funds to be expended. The additional pages are just right out of the budget notebook. So, if you have a chance to at least review the executive summary, I think it gives you a high-level overview. So, thank you, school committee. Thank you, Madam Chair. The next up is, if you want to proceed, would be a salary and benefits review. Again, folks, you have some of this information in your supplemental, and I'll try and call out that page.
I
yes, in your cheat sheet, it's page 25.
I have a question on the teaching assistants. Last year, when the budget was proposed for FY16, you had 25 teaching assistants listed with 4.5 paid for by grant funds. I just, you know, I pulled it out of the last year's budget book. This year, the sheet we have in front of us has 27.5 teacher assistants with 6, I think it is, paid by grant. So we increased from last year's proposed budget for this year to actually starting the year with 2.5 more, even though we had said we need 25. So we've already increased 2.5 going into next year. Are you, and I didn't understand the notations, because are we on top of that looking to add another aid?
No. So we have 25 budgeted last year. 4 were covered in the grant, 3 out of 1.0. One was, that's our preschool TA, and we have a half IDA covered also. Going forward, you're correct, we right now have 27.5. So of that 27.5, 0.5 of that is coming off. You would see that in the reduction on the second page of the support.
Right, yeah.
They're coming off. That was specific extra funding that Suzanne had only this year. We know definitely 100% we're not getting that next year. So the other two TAs, they are both being funded by the grant right now. One of them will be funded by the grant next year. The other one we weren't sure about, so we did put that second TA back in the budget. So we've only over budgeted for the one TA.
Which would be an increase of 3.5.
No, absolutely not.
Well, if the proposed budget for 16 had 25,
yeah,
we're up to 27.5, and it sounded like you just doubled back and said we are adding in the other budget.
No, we are at 27.5 right now.
Yeah.
In this budget that you're looking at, you'll find 27.5.
I did, yeah.
You'll find the reduction of a half in the underneath the personnel changes.
Right.
So now we're at 2. We're going to keep those 2. One of those 2 is going to be paid for by the grant next year. One, the other one, we hope will be paid for by the grant, but we're unsure. So that is budgeted.
All right, so we've...
No,
we've taken
I'm
one. Well, we kind of had. Let me explain this.
I'm just trying.
We've added to
two
our
and a half
responsibility
right now.
We've taken one out of one that is already in here.
Yes.
Was this year paid for by grant? Next year we've moved it to our side, and it's going to be showing up as our expense, not
correct,
covered by a grant. So we've increased the number that we're paying for by one.
That is correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And just when you said something about a comparison to FY16. Proposed the comparisons to the FY16 adopted. Maybe
the proposed. When you.
He's not the right number. We adopted 25
right,
last
yeah,
year.
Yeah.
We are at 27.5 this year.
Right.
That was due to the needs, and luckily
yeah,
the grant
yeah,
was able to pick
yeah,
that up, but we're just going forward, we're not 100% positive
yeah,
on the two.
Yeah. I still don't, for the life of me, understand, and I guess maybe I'll have a conversation at next week's meeting with. About this in more detail, but I still don't understand how the census for IEPs went down significantly, and then there's a statement that we had kids come in, but the census still shows a decrease, and we increased 2.5 positions.
I can't speak to that at all. I, the educational side of that, you have to ask Suzanne.
I think, are we gonna just, how would you like to?
I've asked to have it on the agenda for next week,
yeah,
so I'll get that explanation then. But I just wanted to make sure it was
yeah,
clear. We're moving one over onto our side.
One to our side due to the needs.
Yep.
Any other questions for salaries and benefits?
Hang on one minute. Guidance clerk, right? The clerk typist is in the guidance office.
You have time, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And currently, there's nobody in there? But there's a half time?
There's a half time, this is my plan.
Okay.
So just need to make it a full time.
Okay.
I just want to jump in about the healthcare rate adjustment that we're going to be making for use for next week. We can level it, but I just wanted to let you know that 1% either decrease or increase, or however you want to do it, would be approximately 21,000. So we wanted to take it negative one. I'm just giving you the heads up. Right now, if you level it, you're shaving off 168,000. So if you wanted to go negative one, you add another 21,000 to your savings. If you wanted to go positive one, that's, I mean, it's totally up to you, but I need some
But they don't have any estimate of how far it's going down, correct?
Nothing, so I
can't speak for everyone here, but I would say let's go with the conservative and keep it
level it.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
I think that's the, mm-hmm. the reasonable answer.
Okay. So again, that's 168,000 and you're going to see a decrease in the benefits.
So last year you gave us a breakdown of the 5-year your expenditures for all classifications of overtime and all classifications of substitute. Could you give us that again for this year?
Sure.
What's that represent as a percentage for the line item in there under administrative salary increases?
That is 2% for everyone on the administration page and everyone on the following page on the admin support page. That's what's represented as a 2% for everyone in those two categories.
Okay. Lisa, also, could you tell us what the last year's healthcare reimbursement was? Because we're budgeting for the reimbursement reserve, I want to make sure that number's adequate.
I didn't bring last year's number.
No, not now, not
I
now. Just
oh, okay.
Get it to us.
Okay.
Okay. And the same for the medical and dental changes.
I actually have that. We were $15,000 over budget. We had budgeted $30,000 this year. We've taken that line down. We came in around $46,000 so far. Obviously, people are still making changes, but that has been the norm that four people are coming our way.
Now, I want to make sure I understand what that is. That's $46,000 budgeted for if people choose to go from a single plan to a family plan.
So it's any changes. It's,
okay.
Yeah, it's
okay.
Anything.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Back to some work that somebody else did.
We all received it.
Sherry sent it out to all of us.
Oh, okay.
So if you look at the plot that Mike did, the thought code is the location of our budget. We have more building-based budgets. If you look at the 40s, that's the central office budget, that's where all the copiers are contained. Those other budgets are, you have some funds in the technology budget that is not for copiers.
So Lisa, as I look at that source, one of the things that comes out is one of the big items in there is technical related maintenance agreements and it says reps operation. That's normally, so that could account for that difference.
Okay, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So it just gets caught up in there.
Yeah.
Start my own.
Yeah. Thank you.
Lisa, I'm sorry, on the central office budget for the private school out of district transportation, is that 55,000 the net number or the gross number? Don't you get an offset from the state for that?
So that's the net.
Oh,
you know, you got your client when you were in my office also, that the private school was running really high.
But then it dropped this month, didn't it?
So I'm
going
to have to keep an eye on that
and
see if it changes throughout the year.
So we get an offset on this of how much?
This year, I think.
Oh, wait a minute. I got the projected for next year right in front of me. Hold on. The offset is for next year, 18,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Okay. I noticed on the last invoice, I'm sorry, Mr. Mayor, listen, I know it's a lot to ask to do for $3,000, but I wish we didn't wait for the state to tell us that we no longer have a kid riding on the bus. I wish there was a way we could, by email or by letter, survey the parents at the beginning of the month, saying, is your child still riding the bus, so we can do the notification. Because on that invoice from the state, I know you say the state tells you at the end of the month if anybody is no longer riding, if they notice it, they call and find out. But on the bottom of that invoice, there's also a statement saying, it's the district's responsibility to notify us once you know there's no kid no longer riding the bus, notify us and we'll remove them from the roll. I'd rather have removed from the roll at the beginning of the month than at the end of the month after we've paid for the transportation of that kid. Because I'm seeing in looking at those invoices, one student can make a big difference in that transportation cost for the past year of the bus. So,
it varies every day. It depends on the ridership on the bus, too. And they do keep an eye on that. They do give us credits.
Yeah, but I wish we would solicit from the parents, like in September, at the end of the month, maybe. You know, is your student, right? Because, like, the kids who go to Mount St. Charles, I'm sure the first week, maybe they all take the bus in. But by the end of the month of September, they've all made friends and they're all probably driving in with other kids. So I'd like the parents to verify, if we could, so that we remove it from the bus cost and we don't pay for something, you know, that we haven't been getting service for. But But it's just maybe something to discuss with Mr. Mayo as to how we could do that if we could do that.
It is a complication with that, because they do a monthly survey.
At the end of the month, though?
They do, they adjust, they put right on there the day that the student is removed or change routes or something from right AM, something from just right PM, some right all.
Superintendent, may I ask some general questions about the budget? Is this your minimum budget?
What did John say? Good question. That's a good question. I feel like if we just picked up you picked up some good news on your health care. But I guess at this point in time, I'd hate to go backwards. I mean, this budget at 2.57% actually comes in and it's able to restore three positions that were cut previously. That's all in a big, it's positive. So I think it maintains the things we've asked for. We're definitely trying to address the high school building-based budget. I think part of it, the reason it's coming in, like it's coming in right now at 2.5 or 2.6% is where you're about to go next, and that's the PPS budget. It's really slippery. Lombardi, because it's January, and this starts back in September or October. So to answer your question, you all may feel different, 70 of you will decide.
I'm asking you.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so I did read recently, I think it was Go Local or somewhere like that, that a high school was ranked number 9. Now, I know that might be 9, 11, 6, I don't know where it is, but let's just assume it's 9. Is that, was it 12? Does that sound right?
It was 9 out of 51 actually.
Yeah. They walked up from 14 to 9.
Okay, 14, okay, great. That's great, thank you. Does this, and I know that that's just the high school, does this budget at least maintain?
So I believe with support of their building-based budget increases that they've asked for, the addition of the guidance clerk, which is really important, and the librarian, it does. Keep going. I think you're going somewhere. I'm not sure where.
Mr. McGee?
Yes.
What do we need to get that number closer to 1? How do we get to 8 to 7? What do we need to do? I'm not asking you on the spot right now. I think you got your. I thought I saw something where you do have a presentation down the road, or something. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. I'm not asking you on the spot, but I'd like to know how do we get closer to number 1? Not today.
I think I was going to ask the chair to schedule at your February school committee meeting a presentation that Mr. McGee's been working on with Mr. Pepin and Mr. Boss and other people in this building that has to do with that significant change. So if you would be so kind to just, I think he'll answer that question come February. Mr. McGee, there was a change. Mr. McGee did inform me that in the supplemental budget, he had proposed a substantial program offering change, and he did inform me that in the light of all his work, and we've had many discussions and sessions, that he would like to come in February to present his plan, but not for next year. It would be for 17-18. So I think that's going to answer a lot of your questions.
I want to compliment you for getting to 9, but I want to make sure that you have the support to stay at 9, and hopefully get to 1. And I'm not putting any pressure on the 1, but I don't want to see us go backwards. That's all. And this budget, I'm really confident.
We'll certainly try.
I know on quick review, it looks like the building level budgets haven't gone up by a great percentage, except for the high school. But what you do have to factor in too is there's supplies being purchased under curriculum for each of these buildings in the amounts of about $16,000. And there's also textbooks being purchased through the curriculum department for each for these schools as well. So like for in the high school, for example, it's gone up from high school budget went up from 123,000 to 154,000. But then on top of that, there's about 30,000 of materials, textbook supplies being purchased through curriculum for the high school. So that budget actually went up much more than what the percentage is that says it. And it's the same for all of the budgets of all of the buildings. Their increase was minimal, but then when you put on top of that what's being purchased, and I don't understand that, and I guess that's a question. Well, how do you differentiate or decide when science curriculum materials are going to be purchased through the curriculum office versus through the building level budget? Because in my mind, curriculum supplies would be, you know, things that the curriculum leader is going to use when she runs a class with teachers to instruct, whereas the science kits are actual in-classroom products that the kids are going to use. And I just thought it odd that it wasn't in the building level budget. So, and the same thing with the textbooks. Yeah. So how do you, and I don't see that you've done that before. It kind of like...
That's exactly what's going to be addressed when Claire comes up. If you want to move to Claire and skip over Suzanne, we can do that. She was scheduled next. But your answer, absolutely, we have your answer.
I was only mentioning the building level budget increases. You mentioned they didn't go up that significantly, but when you add the other money on, they do go up significantly.
So, can you hold that until we get to curriculum?
Yep. I want to go back to salaries, though. I do have one other question, and this is an accounting point of view, too. I don't understand why we have a teacher who is a special ed teacher, and she's the district team, whatever, she's got a title that got a $14,000 stipend. But it's my understanding she doesn't teach. Why is she included under teacher salaries versus administrator salaries? Because in my mind, she's performing the role of an assistant special ed director.
She's a union employee.
All right, why is that not an administrative position?
You can negotiate that out if you'd like. I think that's between you and the
NCAA. Well, I think when I look at it and I look at the per pupil expenditure cost breakdown, it's kind of like we're giving ourselves credit for having one teacher when we really don't have a teacher, but we're not giving ourselves credit for having another administrator when we really kind of have someone in an administrative role. So the reporting, in my mind, to RIE gets a little cloudy when you have someone who doesn't teach still being counted as a teacher.
I think that's something that is a good point the committee may want to discuss at another time or for negotiations. Gentlemen? Sorry, go ahead. Go for it.
Well, she's in the union because she is considered a special education teacher in the past. She was a DBT, which stands for Diagnostic Prescriptive Teacher. She was responsible for doing all the testing to qualify students for special education. She no longer does the testing portion of that, but she runs the teams in all of the four buildings. So she's in charge of handling all the team paperwork, scheduling the evaluations. It's not an administrative position, it's an actual teacher position. However, the stipend is for her to be an early childhood coordinator. Many districts have coordinators. They're not considered administrative positions. They're kind of pseudo-administrative. But those people, those coordinators, are also in unions. If you look into other districts, that's how they manage it, because it's a small stipend, and it's a portion of actual duties.
Does any other district our size have this type of position?
Districts actually have early childhood positions.
No, I'm talking about the full-time person who coordinates the team meetings and sends out the notices. What you just described
maybe
as far as
something different, but all districts have that person to be responsible for that. It could be a different person in every single building, which would not be cost effective for us.
Well, I guess I'm relating it to my own experience. It was the principal, the special ed director, or the chair of the special ed department who did what this person is doing in each building.
And so she's like a chair of the special ed department. We don't have that.
Yeah, except we do have a special ed department chair.
We have a department head for the high school, yes. But we don't have someone to go to all the different team meetings. There are different roles and responsibilities with both of them. I'll be glad to get you the job description if you'd like.
I would like to see another school district our size that has this position. Do you know of any off the top of your head?
I mean, I came from Cranston. We can't really
You can't compare Cranston with the population we have here.
I don't really compare my district to other districts. My only comparison is Cranston and Pawtucket, both of which were very large districts, which had actually more than one person doing the job that this one person is doing.
I'm getting at here is I would rather have an extra exploratory teacher, which directly impacts the kids and gives them more opportunities, than to have a salary teacher actually perform what I see as an administrative function that's not teaching. And I'd like that to be distributed to other people as responsibilities. I guess I can only relate it to the system that I came from, but it wasn't, you know, it was the building principal, it was the guidance director, it was the special ed department head, it was the vice principal who chaired those meetings, and we didn't, and yet we had more exploratories. And I'm not happy with the exploratories, I'll give you that much. So,
and I understand. I think that one of the things that
if we have a choice of funding one thing or the other, my choice would be fund the exploratory teacher.
And
find another way to accomplish this.
You have to understand that. You know, there are, you know, and I respect where you came from, however, in my line of work, we have guidelines, and we have rules and regulations we have to follow, and we have to meet timelines. We have 60-day timelines, and every single quarter, we're evaluating on those timelines, and we're 100% compliant every single quarter. And if we're not compliant, then we're responsible to come up with some big plans that could cost our grant. Our grant is not huge. Most districts get somewhere in a million, over the millions. We get $400,000. We have a very small grant. That grant helps to provide programs for our students. If we start delegating these responsibilities to five different people and we have issues with timelines, we're going to be losing grant money. And now we're going to be coming back to the school committee and saying, we've got to fund $400,000 worth of special education programs for our students. So it's a very crucial position that needs to be handled by one person. And it needs to be done effectively in order for me to be able to do my job.
It also affects the criteria by which decisions are made, which is huge.
Huge.
Huge. There's consistency there because of her and working with you. Otherwise, you can have decisions made on five different criteria.
They wouldn't just follow the regs as far as the criteria for eligibility? It's discretion?
No, it's not discretion, but now you're giving responsibility to someone, no disrespect to my colleagues, but you're giving that responsibility to people that don't have that special ed background. And now someone needs to have to help manage that when this person can do that entire job and is able to make sure that the team runs smoothly, that all these kids, our timelines are met. I mean, it's a huge responsibility. I also cover a part-time clerk out of my grant because those timelines are so crucial and because we're monitored by the state. It's a pretty significant job. I know it seems to you like it, you know, it's just sitting and cheering a team, but there's so much more that goes into it.
I'm not saying that at all. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying, if you have a limited amount of resources, I would prefer myself, and it's just my own opinion, to be funding a classroom teacher. Kids at the middle school and the high school can have more exploratory opportunities rather than a semi-administrative job. I know we don't see eye to eye on what it is, but that's just, I'm just saying my own personal feelings.
We get you some, because I picked up on some, you're looking for some data to compare information. Let me go to RIDE, see if I can get you that. And candidly, maybe it doesn't have to be either or choice, Mike. Why does it have to be either or?
Because it's limited dollars. We all know that. And you don't want to grow so quickly that you can't sustain the growth that you promoted. So.
Yeah, I know firsthand the value that the position has brought because we didn't have consistency years ago, and especially in terms of running meetings, decision making, working with parents. And so I just know that. I mean, the committee can do what they want.
I'm just trying to finish.
So you can do what you want, but I would recommend it would really set us back. So.
Lisa, is there one other question? Speaking of the grant money, the budget for the grant is in, you know, on that one page, is the breakdown of what salaries and stuff. It's kind of pain in the neck to try to figure out how they match up with the salary spreadsheet and pulling out to see, okay, what's that, does that total that? Is there, there must be a little budget that you did come up with that special ed, that grant fund budget, correct?
So, it's very preliminary, you know. As a matter of fact, we just received our awards for our grants just 2 weeks at the end of December. So it's very preliminary, and what we do is just pretty much mimic what we had budgeted for this year, because we didn't even have an awarded grant at the time that we developed this.
Okay.
Not too many specifics that.
Okay, I got you.
Can offer.
Speaking of the grant, I'm looking at your response. You have one teacher assistant, 23 grants, and previously covered by grant funds. So what happened to the grant?
So that was the two that I was talking about that got hired this year, the 2.5 that got hired this year. We know the half is going away. We know there's no way we're getting that money. However, the two that we hired this year, we were able to cover in the grant combination. But next year, we're not sure that we can carry two, but we can't have to still carry that TA, so we have to move those funds to the general
same
fund.
Grant number or the phone?
We don't know. We have no idea.
The award doesn't change very much. We had a discussion about this actually amongst, you know, the directors in the state. They don't look at, they look at various numbers, but they don't look at, like, giving a cost of increase or the cost of
increase. Get grant funds? The state grant?
Yes.
Yeah.
The
state's grant
federal money.
Federal.
So the feds are
getting. It has very specific guidelines for what it's used for.
I have a question. Does the line item for contracted services outside evaluations, is that part of your budget? Is most of that money in your budget?
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
The contracted services for outside evaluations, is in our weekly report, we have a census update, and I don't see much change in the census update. What drives the need for an additional $30,000 of outside evaluations for population that seems to be pretty much the same? It's increasing from 118 to 149,000.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. That, it's not for outside evaluations. That's just the actual, what it's called, category. It's contracted services. So that increase is for the consultative supports of Momentum, which is our, we used to have Grogan, and last year we switched over to Momentum. They're a team of experts that come out, they're behavior specialists, they come out and work with our clinicians, they develop plans for our kids, they work with many of our children on the spectrum, but with any of the children who are struggling in all of the different four schools. So they have really been a huge benefit to all of our teams. We've been able to keep many students from going to more restricted placements, we've kept students from out of district with their supports. They also come in and they do training. They've just been like very essential. So with my decrease, I kind of compensated by I had a decrease in outside tuitions. I did increase that line item because I found that their services have helped on the other end by keeping our students in the district, giving them the supports that they need. So that's where that increase is. But as you can see, the other contracted services, for example, are based solely on student need. So in the past, our O&M, which is Orientation, Mobility, and Vision, which is services that are provided, we get that service through the state, through the Sherlock Center. They send the staff, and then they bill us. Those services have decreased significantly because of, I'm basing it solely on the students that are in front of me right now who require those services. So that's why that went down this year. And then the physical therapy, as well as the OT, that's based on student need again, and looking at how much we were billed last year and putting a little cost of increase in there for cost of living. But that's about it. It's really based on the students in front of me right today. So that could change.
Well, you brought me to my next question, which was you reduced the tuitions by almost $170,000. Do you really feel comfortable with the figure, or do you really think you're going to have enough money?
That's a really good question. For two reasons, I say I'm uncomfortable. I have decreased it because, again, as you know, Mrs. Nato, we're planning this so early. So I'm basing it on the actual students that are sitting in front of me, and I'm basing it on those bills. I'm asking the agencies, what are your increases going to be? Most of the time they laugh and say it's kind of early to tell you that. So I try to base it on 3 to 4% of an increase Usually it doesn't go much higher than that, with the exception of BICO, which is pretty expensive. But I do worry, because my budget, my total budget went down about 200,000, one of the things that I have to really be careful with is what's called maintenance of effort. And what maintenance of effort means is that the local budget needs to expend more money to support special ed than my grant does. So the total budget, not just what's in mine, but the total local budget has to be able to support more of the needs of the special ed population than I'm supporting in a grant. And we were very close last year. However, it would not be fair to create, you know, these huge increases to add on 170,000 when it's not there. The only thing we could do is something that was mentioned before, which is put an unanticipated line item in there for unanticipated tuitions. I did not put that in here because I felt like I was just going to go on bare bones and do the best I could and hope for the best. But the maintenance of effort does concern me because there is a big difference.
What month of the year do you have a better idea of what to expect from tuitions and school population?
Never do I ever know about student population, because after I did this budget, actually have a new student in an out-of-district placement effective today. I have another one who's possibly going to be in an out-of-district placement, who's also moved in, but right now is in the midst of being placed. So the placements are always like this. Today I could have 19, tomorrow I could have 20, next week I could have 18, and then I could have 23. It really depends on movement. On the tuition increases, I can get a better feel for what those are going to be, usually in the spring. So I can tell you, like, maybe the increase in Bradley will be 4%, because they'll know that by April. It still doesn't really help you, because I can't tell you how many students are going to be in out-of-district placements, because I don't know who's going to move in. I could have a family move in next week. Three children are in outside placements, and I have to follow those IEPs.
You know, and very, on the census you gave us, you didn't show us what, you showed us how many students were in out-of-district placements, but you didn't show at what grade level. But the stage two application has a form from the state that identifies what grade level the out-of-placement kids were in. And if I look at that, it looks as though next year we'll have, this year, did I say, John, I showed you that. Was it this year? This coming year, we'll have five who should graduate.
Yep.
You can't go by that.
I know, because it's. I know there are kids who go beyond 18.
They go till they're 21.
But my question is, did you reduce any of these placements or numbers based on the fact that you have kids who are going to graduate at 18 and are currently getting these services?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So, was it around 5 or?
No, I based it on 19. 19 is what I'm going to have for next year if nothing changes. Well, actually 20 as of today. So I based it looking at whether or not those students are close to graduation. I do credit checks with all of my students their junior year.
Okay.
And then I have students that will be in school until they're 21.
Okay. I was uncomfortable with how much the out-of-district tuitions were reduced. So I feel better having heard that and the other rest of the explanation. Because I thought we were kind of lowballing it a little too much.
I kind of felt that way too,
but the reality is we take our guidance from you and all of you, and we do this budget at that point in time, and I think Suzanne wrote that right in her summary. It's very unpredictable, and I kind of wanted to circle back to Mary's question. I believe April, you know, I know at least 2 months in the school year, and we could have move-ins, but I do think come April, we would have a little better idea in terms of what FY17 might be for out-of-district placements. But then it just narrows down the wild card ones to, you know, May and June. And then we've had people move in over the summer. So I just think that, I mean, you've seen this enough that, I mean, there's no answer we can give you. It's not finite. You have to be nimble. And that's where we're at this point in time. But you're right. It's a big hit. It's a big hit.
But I can also address another reason why it went down was because you guys were great and agreed to let me start the partnership at the high school, which is going beautifully. You'll have that in your report for next week. But with the ability to do that partnership classroom, the daily tuition rate for those kids went from 308 a day down to 198 a day. So that in itself was a huge decrease. So if you've got five or six kids that are going from 307, 308 to 198, that's a big difference. So because of the ability to have a partnership classroom, also your ability to allow me to do a self-contained preschool, which is running beautifully as well.